Dr. Mantravadi.
Let me separate into two segments here. Let me address the question, how does Hindus relate to God, or what I call the scriptural terms, Brahman? We already said that God is manifesting everywhere, in everyone. So since every form is a manifestation of the formless divine, the choice is left to the devotee to relate, to worship, to any image or form from which you call it, some may call it idol, and we call it icon. It is simply an intermediary step. The images are intermediary step for you to relate to the divine. For example, a young man with a photograph of his beloved in his wallet, or any of you that carry the pictures of the family. You're not really relating to the piece of paper. You're relating to what it represents. An icon or an idol that Hindus pray serves exactly the same purpose. As the infinite forms are nothing but divine principle, you can worship one's own favorite form or icon, either at the temple on special days, or at the altar of one's home on a daily basis. Every Hindu home has a special altar allocated for worship. Depending upon one's own knowledge, a variety of prayers are offered, which are again nothing but the descriptions of the various attributes of the divine. And all of them has universality in them. Some relate to the divine principle through the scriptural study, either independently or through a study group. Others, because of the traditional background, just worship and ask for grace, for happiness, inner peace, for themselves, and for anyone and everyone around them. Since it is difficult to pray or relate to something that is formless, you need a form, you need an image, you need an icon to relate to. Since every form is a manifestation of the formless, you can have any image or many images. Some call it many gods. That's not true. There is only God. A variety of images or icons that you see either in the Hindu temples or in the homes of your Hindu friends represents many facets, many aspects of the divine principle. And the Hindu symbol, you see it on the flyer that you have, it's called Om. And discussion of the Om is an elaborate topic. So let me address the second component of the question. How do they obey or follow? From the Hinduism standpoint, the religious way of life, the obeying or the following, consists of three aspects: prayer, living an ethical life, and study of scriptures, which is what all the speakers have addressed. A ritual is a physical expression of love and devotion. A prayer establishes your relationship to the divine. Flag hoisting is a ritual. It shows our patriotism and the love towards what it represents. The second part of the religious life is an ethical way of life that is leading a life based on the values that I've talked about. There are 20 values given in a scriptural text. We call it Bhagavad Gita. The first and the foremost of the values that are described are non-injury, non-violence, physical or verbal. Second is truthfulness. The third is the life in constant remembrance of that divine principle. The other values are accommodation, purity, constant even-mindedness in the occurrence or in the face of desirable and undesirable circumstances. That is the acceptance of the outcome as it is. Absence of pride, ego, pretense, straightforwardness, dispassion, service to one's teacher. Teacher comes up everywhere in the scriptures. To the community, these values are universal. They're applicable to anyone from any faith. Life is a series of actions and experiences, and any discussion on Hinduism as it relates to the question of obey or follow is not complete without the understanding of the law of cause and effect. We call it karma yoga. Humans are endowed with a free will, as was already said, because of which you can choose to act, not act at all, or act differently. The law of karma states that you are creators of your own destiny. You reap what you sow. For every action, there is a result. Righteous actions based on the values described are noble actions, which are beneficial to others. They create a positive grace. We call it punya. There's no direct translation in English. Those actions that are harmful to others, either directly or indirectly, they cause a negative result, negative grace. We call it papa. These positive and negative graces are accumulated and manifest as success or happiness or failure or sorrow, either in this life or, as we believe in reincarnation, in the next life. So the law of karma states that each individual reaps fruits of their actions performed in this life or in the former lives. You will reap the benefit of your noble actions either in this life or next life. It never goes to your waste. With regard to practical day-to-day living, Hindu scriptures teach us we have control only on the quality and the quantity of the effect that you put into an action. You have no control on the results thereof. You have the choice to act, but you don't control the results. The outcome depends upon many unknowns, and you cannot control them. So the acceptance of whatever the action that, and whatever the results of the action, and being level-headed about it, and being dispassionate about the results is the key to inner peace. Intention, therefore, is important. Your motive is the spirit. The action is the form. That's how the people of Hindu faith obey, follow, and relate.